Welcome to the Planning Board meeting for Wednesday, April 12th, 2017. As you can see, we're not in our normal place. We're at the HCAM Studios, and we thank HCAM for both the meeting space and also for taping the Planning Board meeting today. As I think many of you know, our town hall suffered a fairly large flood, and we'll probably be availing ourselves of this nice spot for the next couple of meetings, I think. We'll see how the forecast is for putting town hall back together again. The agenda tonight, we have two public hearings and a vote on the master plan for tonight. I'd like to also make note that the marathon is this Monday, so we welcome, wish everyone a wonderful marathon weekend. And also, the election slates are set, and we have three board members that chose not to run for re-election. And so, Matt and Vincent and Brian, thank you very much for your service. We'll probably do a few more of those because you've got a couple more meetings that you still have to go. And the rest of the board members, don't get used to these cushy seats that they have here because hopefully they'll put town hall back together. Okay, we'll start our 7:30 public hearing, 221 Pond Street. This is a scenic road permit. David and Heather, are you here? Come on up in the hot seat. Yeah, Paul, do you want to join us up here?
So just if anybody's speaking, they have to speak at the mic.
Okay.
Even if we're sitting here?
Well, you have to stand if you're speaking.
Okay. All right. Okay. We have our tree warden. This is a joint hearing with the tree warden, Paul Gleason, our tree warden. Why don't you stand and give a little quick presentation to the board as to what you want to do?
Okay. I am David Krauss. We currently live at 219 Pond Street, and the lot next door we recently bought and are hoping to build a new home on that lot. And it requires a curb cut on the scenic road, and given the various places where the house could be and the septic system, there's really only kind of one place for the curb cut to come through, and it appears to affect potentially two trees. I don't know if we can save them as you widen the driveway at the end to be able to get a fire truck in or whatever, but it comes close to the two trees that are on the description.
Okay, so this request is for 35 feet of wall removal and the two trees, one of the 6-inch maple and a 16-inch partially dead oak. Paul, did you have any questions or comments on the trees? Yeah, I guess so. Why don't you stay right up there? Sure, David.
A little confusing, but we'll get it.
I went down to the site. I saw both trees. The maple, if you're facing the lot to the right, looks like it's going to be right in the middle of the pathway of the driveway. It's a very tall, skinny tree. It's not of any great consequence. The oak is about halfway out the door as it is right now, between the amount of dead and broken limbs, the effects of last summer's drought, and the fact that I'm sure the gypsy moth feasted on it last year also. So this is a tree that I would be taking down sooner or later. So if I have absolutely no objection to either tree being removed.
Okay. I just note for the audience and planning board members, I don't think we've ever denied anyone having access to their property. I mean, that would be, if we were to say no, that would be a taking, and we're not into that. The care that we have for the scenic road, typically we would require in a condition that the stones that come from the wall be placed wherever there's gaps maybe along that property. We do not like to use them as a driveway apron type thing. And I'm just going back to some histories of different ones that we've done. So I think there was a gap on the, maybe the northern version of, when I went out to look at it, maybe 5-10 feet or maybe, and that would probably work well for the, at least that many feet of them.
Yep.
And then I'm sure you've got a few spots elsewhere on it.
There's actually a few spots, especially down further. We own the lot on the other side of our house as well, and there are larger gaps there.
Okay.
That we would propose to fill in.
Okay. And a lot of, I hopefully a lot of you guys in, also went in and saw the site. It's a pretty uphill portion, and I assume that that is the reason why 35 feet had to come. I think after you make your V to get in, you could also add some of the stones back in along, you know, whatever the fire department isn't going to require.
Agreed.
Because if we could minimize a 35-foot gap, I think everyone would be much more appreciative. Are there questions from other members of the planning board?
Yes, please.
Go ahead.
Mr. Tree Warden, in your email you said that the oak tree is not likely to be going anywhere soon, barring some unforeseen weather event. So that does not sound like it should be cut down.
The context of that remark was because the applicants were afraid that it was going to fall over before their building began and their site work. And so I went down with the intention of determining, you know, was it an imminent threat? And, you know, it's not an imminent threat, but as I said, the tree has got, you know, so many broken limbs, including a large broken leader on the right side as you face it, that has been there for so long that there is now going to be a rot column all the way down the center of the tree to the root system. So while it's not an imminent threat, it's, you know, it's a tree that should be removed.
Do we know if there is a rot column, or is we think there is a rot column?
No, there is a rot column. You know, I mean, there's no question in my mind that it's there.
Thank you.
So it's really just a question of time before that tree would be.
Absolutely, yeah.
But again, in that context, it's a question of time, in black and white, not likely to be going anywhere soon. And it's an oak tree, so
yes,
I'm a little
but
bit sensitive.
The follow-up remark is barring something unforeseen.
All right.
All right, so that tree is a
new driveway.
Huh?
Like a new driveway wanting to be put in place.
Yeah, I certainly would want it.
That's
by
my concern.
Yeah. So, like I said, as tree warden, I have a limited budget. If I had more money, I'd probably have already held a hearing myself and taken it down. Well, that's how little I think of this particular tree. Anybody else?
So typically we would do conditions on maybe a replacement of a tree.
Yeah, I did write some today, but not having access to equipment, I wasn't able to print them out, so I can read them to you.
Okay.
So the first one was, as mitigation for the tree removal, the applicant shall plant and maintain 2 shade trees on the front of the lot on private property. The species and size of the tree shall be subject to the approval of the tree warden. And then the second one is, the stones removed from the driveway opening shall be retained and used to fill in the existing gap in the stone wall along Pond Street. Stone shall not be used on the driveway apron.
Okay. Now, we're defining an apron as going in or out, but if you wanted them on the same line that they currently are, only they're going down a little bit because you're sloping, that would be fine.
Mm-hmm. I have one more concern.
Go ahead.
You were mentioning fire safety and everything. I would like to see it only a 20-foot portion of the stone wall, not 35-foot. That would fit more with the fire requirements for their trucks, and more in tune with the scenic roadway aspects of what we're trying to keep in place.
Well, I think what they're doing, Frank, is they're going to have to take off 7 or 8 feet on each wing of the pavement. The pavement is the 20 feet, and then 35, you put 7 or 8 feet on each side. Because if you look at that lot, it does one of these. Mm-hmm. So
I have a steep driveway too, I understand.
And, yeah, go
say
ahead.
Something to that?
Sure, because we had originally proposed 20 feet as the max, and we were, I think, told by the fire chief to extend it, given the current construction. We would be happy to minimize it. That's our intent, and the proposed pieces that were there were perfectly fine with us. That is our intent.
Are they here to comment or for something else?
Morgan, you can ask.
We have members from the fire department here today. Do you guys have a comment on this?
No, not at this time. Chief Slam is working on that.
Okay.
I mean, we've seen that the fire department is requiring much more access to individual houses than they ever have done before, and he has the authority to issue or stop an occupancy report. So, I mean, if that's what we're hearing, the chief is telling him that they're 35 feet. You know, you got to remember, this is going to be kind of banked for a long while. Mm-hmm. So, you know, it.
Yeah, to Frank's comment, you know, I understand the fire chief had requested, you know, 20-foot clearance so that they can make the turn to get into people's driveways. But if the chief is looking for more than 20 feet, I would certainly support that.
Okay, I think we heard the two conditions. Are those acceptable?
More than acceptable, yep.
Okay. The only other thing on the condition, it ought to be a caliber tree of like a subdivision tree, whatever that is, was it 3 inches or whatever?
Yeah, I had said the size and species up to the approval of the tree warden, but if you want to be more specific.
Oh, okay. Well,
we're more than happy to show him our proposal before we buy and plant.
Sure. The subdivision tree is what, a 3-inch tree?
Two and a half.
Two and a half? Okay, so we don't want anyone's expectation that we're going to be putting an 8-inch tree back in.
I see.
Or a 1/2-inch tree.
Got it.
Okay, so I'd entertain a motion to approve the scenic road cutting with cutting of the removal of the two trees and removal of the stone wall with the conditions that Jennifer said.
So moved. Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good luck with everything, folks.
Okay. So we are 15 minutes before the next public hearing, so let's work on a few other things on the bottom of our list so that we can end at 10. Okay, the next thing is the master plan implementation plan. We did receive from Parks and Rec the final pieces in our implementation plan. The board members have already reviewed the meat of the proposal. Are there any other discussions on this before I entertain a motion to approve the master plan? I'm seeing none. I guess I'll entertain a motion to approve the master plan.
So moved. So
second.
Moved. Second. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries.
Yay.
And thank you for Jennifer and Elaine for doing all the work, and all the authors on the planning board, the editors of each of the chapters, and the public for their input. And
I'd like to say, through the chair, fantastic job. Thank you very, very much for all the work and hard dedication that you put into it. Kobe, you as well, and everybody else that is on the board, thanks for all the camaraderie that we put together for this.
Through the chair.
Yeah.
Just for those who think we're doing it very quickly, we've been working on this for 2 years.
Yeah.
So it's taken a lot of time, and many of the sections have come up for discussion at our meeting. So it's a lot of work that has a lot of input. So even though this is a very quick session, don't think the process was very quick.
Okay, thank you. Let's move on to the Legacy Farms Road North opening. This is just a follow-up on it. Those people that are there, the weather was kind of iffy, but we got it done. Thank you to Weston Nurseries for allowing us to use the greenhouse. I believe Elaine counted people. We had at least 75 people in attendance, which was great. Thank you to the media that all covered it. We had great media from just about every one of the local outlets, and all sorts of videos and pictures, and everything was really great. We did send a letter, was it Monday or Tuesday, to Juan Vega, the Assistant Secretary, for thanking him for coming out to speak to us from the Commonwealth. So I think that kind of settles it up. The road is now open. Shortly after, I reminded Roy that he needs to, he has two more signs he has to put up, because there's a directional sign that says to Ashland and to Legacy Road North, and the other one is to Southborough and whatever. That was a condition, I think, of the master plan special permit.
Yes.
or the subdivision, one of the two.
Master plan special permit.
Okay. So we're done with that. Let's go on to the minutes. We're moving along real well here. Minutes for February 27th. I have one change. It's on page 6. At the end of the first paragraph, Kobe, you have LNG metering station. It should be just gas gate metering station. We were talking about the that potential Eversource project off of Elm Street. So it's just gas gate instead of LNG. And that's the only thing I had with the minutes. Anyone else have any comments to the minutes of April 27th?
Seeing February 27th.
Or February 27th, yes.
Russia.
Okay. Entertain a motion to approve the minutes for February 27th, 2017. Moved.
Second.
Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye. Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. Now for the minutes on...
About the minutes, though?
Oh.
What they... We approved them, but what they say in the minutes about the gatehouse, some abutters have asked me to check with you to see the process that is expected to proceed from now.
Excuse me. Okay, process. The process is the Eversource is going to submit sometime sooner than later to the DPU their proposed plans. Within 45 days of that submittal, I believe the DPU will have to hold a hearing within Hopkinton. And maybe we'll get it done at Elmwood School, would be where I would propose to do it.
Exactly.
Then that gets public comment. The town needs to decide whether they want to intervene on behalf of either opposing it or trying to influence. The only one that can really influence this hearing process is if you're an intervener. You might be able to get standing if you're an abutter, and certainly the town can get standing. And that ends up being a very long and fairly expensive process. It's very legalistic, it's sworn testimony, it's the whole bit. And we have a very bad track record with DPU. The latest case would be the substation on South Street, where everything the town said, the DPU ignored and gave them blanket zoning exemption. Mm-hmm. And that's what they are basically asking for this item. But you've got to fight the fight. I would encourage everyone, when the public hearing gets announced, that they come to that and speak their mind. And I also encourage people to ask the selectmen to make the decision to intervene.
Which is my other question, the selectmen own that?
Yes.
Choice.
And this is not, I mean, the planning board could take up a resolution, but that would just be one further item that would be part of the public hearing process.
Okay, thank you.
Yep. Okay, so now I think we're on March 13th minutes. Any comments?
Did you close out that last minute thing?
Yes.
Okay. Yeah, we closed out the February 27th. So now we're on March 13th. Any comments, questions on those? entertain a motion to approve as written.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, we're done with minutes. And we're still got a little bit of time. Warrant articles. Let's see, do you have that in your...
In my memo on page 5, it starts...
Okay, there's a couple of these that we have not made a recommendation on yet. The first one is the utility structures. This was basically after Frank's introduction, you kind of led into this one pretty good.
Okay.
What the planning board did is we submitted an article for town meeting on utility structures. And this would allow them to be permitted by special permit by the Board of Appeals. And right now, for example, this gas gate is not allowed per zoning where it is. So the planning board couldn't approve it. It would have to be at least a use variance by the ZBA to do it. Typically, the Eversource tries not to go get those because they can get them easier from the state. But it costs a lot of money for them, costs a lot of money for us. So the thought of this is to give them a way to maybe get it, or any other project. Not necessarily it's a given, because quite frankly, this one probably shouldn't be located where it is. But if there was one that just needed a use for it, like the telephone exchange in another part of town, etc., where there, but they can, but the ZBA can also put conditions on it, which would might take care of some of the problems with whatever the project is. So this just gives utilities another way to go at it, as opposed to just going directly to the DPU at Boston, where and the thought was, and we've discussed it on the board, was that maybe they'll take their money that they would use on lawyers and put it into mitigation. And quite frankly, if the town doesn't like what they see, they won't grant the special permit. You know, requires a supermajority vote of the Board of Appeals. So that's what this one is on. It has raised wording with and so we've got that in there. So we've talked about it a lot. Does anyone want to offer a we've got it on the warrant. The question is, do we want to recommend it to town meeting? That's for this.
Yeah. Chair. Yeah. If you could just elaborate on number 3E, the insertion of, maybe that would give a better inference on some of it.
Okay. It's 3E says above ground structures or facilities related to the distribution, collection, transmission, disposal for a fee of water, sanitary sewer, gas, television services, data, telephone services, or electric power, provided that no special permit shall be required to pursuant to this section for structures or facilities accessory to a residential use. So basically, if it's used in the house, you're okay. For wireless facilities, because basically they're covered under the the cell tower bylaw. For wind energy, because we have a section on that that defines how to do that, or for photovoltaic portions of it. So we have another separate bylaw on solar farms. So basically, they're exempted from this because we have a bylaw on each of those other items. And that was town council's comments.
Thank you.
Okay. Do I see a motion to recommend this one to town meeting?
Moved.
Do I hear a second?
Second.
Further discussion?
I'd like to say something. I think previously we needed more time to think about it, and I do thank Jennifer for putting the raised wording in all together in one cohesive section. It makes more sense this way. We didn't have additional questions, as it turned out. So I just wanted to thank Jennifer.
Okay.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, discussion point?
Yes.
So really, essentially, what this does is it allows another option for the utility, as opposed to going directly to DPU, to go through either the planning board to get the proposal through, but allows some control.
Yes.
That's essentially what I'm...
Yeah. The Zoning Board of Appeals...
ZBA.
Would require a use variance, and they are typically on use variances, there's a very high standard for that type of use. But this would be, instead, it would be a special permit. It would be the equivalent, I guess, of a use variance.
Yep.
And to their discretion, they can...
They can still go.
Yeah, make it go through.
They can have all sorts of conditions based on their public hearing that they would hold.
Exactly.
So, okay, I think we're ready for a vote. All those that wish to recommend this to town meeting, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Looks like it's unanimous, so it carries. Okay, the next one in that same mode is the sign bylaw. And basically, we had a lot of discussion. I think a lot of it was summarized in one of the minutes we just approved. But basically, this has to do with tightening up our sign bylaws that would not allow a sign above the first story of a building except for in the industrial area. Were there other comments, questions on this one? All set?
Yep.
Look for a motion to recommend this to town meeting.
So moved.
Second.
Moved, seconded. Okay, I think we're ready for a vote. All those in favor recommending the sign bylaw changes to town meeting, say aye.
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 Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, we're moving right along today, which is good. Let's see. We got about 2.5 minutes till we're at. Correspondence. In your package, you saw a table that talked about students in the Hopkinton Public Schools from Legacy Farms. It's just in there for information. I think it's pretty much on projection.
Yes, it is.
I'd like you to maybe do a little bit more breakdown.
Okay.
We have the data to break it down by, I'll say, house unit bedrooms. And therefore, we can maybe fine-tune the north side estimate a little bit better. There are, for most people, on the north side, the mix of 2 and 3 bedroom units is less than it is on the south side. So if you just forecast the south side, which also has 15 single-family houses in here, which are 4-bedroom units. If you just forecast the south side into the north side, you would probably overestimate the number of school kids. So we have enough data.
So this is actual numbers, though, so I'm not sure what you're asking, because the north side has no houses on it yet.
Right.
So.
No, what I'm asking is we take the south side and kind of where we have a number of kids per house unit,
mm-hmm.
do it, figure it out per bedroom or you know, it does a 2-bedroom versus a 3-bedroom versus a 4-bedroom have additional kids? The data that's in this table is, we have more data that backs this up.
Okay.
So.
I guess we'll have to talk about it because I still don't understand what you're asking.
Okay, we'll work on it.
So but what you're saying is the data that we have on the students in the Hopkinton Public Schools from the Legacy Farms project is on par for what we had projected.
Yes.
We're not over, we're not.
No.
Good.
They're on track.
They're
good.
On track. And it's kind of interesting to see how the apartment complex varies. A lot of times I think it goes up in the fall where kids get their, if you're building a house in Hopkinton, you might rent an apartment there to get your foot in the door during the school year. So we see some of that area.
Mr. Chairman, I do think that's important to have a baseline to understand that we are on track versus what was forecasted. I think people sometimes, I hear feedback that says, hey, we underestimated the number. Well, it sounds like we didn't. It sounds like we are on with what the estimates were. And I don't know where the baseline started, but to show that there's really not that much of a delta versus estimate.
If you go back 10 years ago, all the school population folks were projecting about a 300 student deficit in the schools. And so this was considered a nice thing by the school department to keep the number of kids and the number of teachers level. And as you kind of know, on the elementary school building, basically, you know, we built that and started construction with thinking it was the same number of kids coming into school or into Hopkinton. I mean, that wasn't built because of Legacy Farms. That building was built because Center School has gotten to be a little less than desirable.
Yep. Yeah.
Mr. Chair?
Sure.
It is important, though, you know, to Fran's point, that the people do understand that, you know, the time that was put into the planning of Legacy Farms, you know, accounted for the growth, and that our projections for the amount of students coming into the town are on track with where the actual numbers are.
Correct.
You know, because I do hear a lot from people saying that the growth is much higher than we ever anticipated, and it's clearly not.
Mm-hmm. So I can see if we can add like a column with like the baseline projection numbers, what Judy Barrett had projected when she did the study, original study. If that would be helpful as a comparative.
But through the chair, I think Ken is asking for an extrapolation from the south side based on bedroom. Have a rate on the bedroom. So the one bedroom rate of kids is this much, and two bedrooms this much.
Okay.
And then extrapolate that on what is on what we're planning
what
on,
will
on
be
the north
on the
side.
Side. Okay.
And then that's more based on what we're seeing in mm-hmm. current. So the trend is the extrapolation.
All right, I think I understand what you're saying.
Yeah.
Big data.
Obviously, that over a 10-year period of time, family planning and number of kids and all those things are influenced by all sorts of different economic conditions and whatever. Anyway, okay, I think we're ready for our other big hearing of the day, because it is, I think, 8:00 at this point, if I'm reading that clock right. In fact, we're 2 minutes off. Okay, I'm going to call the public hearing special permit for the concept plan for a subdivision off of Chamberlain Street and Whalen Road. This is REC Hopkinton LLC. Where's Paul in this group?
Okay. They're signing in right now.
Oh.
The line at the door.
Okay.
Do we think we're going to need more seats? Or?
There's overflow in the studio
okay.
B.
Thanks.
And there's a monitor in there.
Why don't we go
get
Vincent?
There's a monitor. There's an overflow in that next studio, and there's a monitor with speakers so people can hear in there.
Thank you.
Vincent, can
we're
you go get
Paul? We're limited to capacity for occupancy, so.
Can you go
did
get
the
Paul
best we could.
To come through?
Fire
department.
Send the new guy.
Sorry, how I looked in here.
Yes.
Yes.
And so if you have easels, they should be set up on that over there. Yeah.
30 more people out in the hallway trying to get in. Now I have to go all the way down halfway to the door. Like a block party.
Two options.
Whoever's speaking has to say that mic.
Okay.
Sorry. Just because we have overflow in the other room, they need to be able to hear you.
It's happening.
Okay. We kind of introduced it. We have a full board. Let me start off with the discussion. We have probably a lot of people that haven't been to a planning board meeting for a long time.
We still have a lot of people coming in. Can we hold off a minute until there's a lot of people out there that might want to hear all this?
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Okay. We typically don't require anyone to sign into the board.
Well, what's we did that for Kobe because.
Oh, for Kobe? Okay. Okay.
It's all mine. Because sometimes people forget to say who they are, where they live, yeah. And I have a clue.
Trying to get used to our new digs here. We're trying to get used to our new digs.
You don't want to block.
We'll be here as long as we'll have us.
I don't know. Yeah.
Can we get air conditioning?
We get air conditioning in here.
Can we get it in there? Yeah, you and I. It doesn't help us, does it?
Yeah, that's a scary.
Nobody knew where it was. Nobody knew where it was. No, Chuck was out getting dinner. Nobody knew where it was. I wasn't there. They called me and they're like, we're all out of the building. So I was like,
this Tuesday, I won't see the.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, like Norman's office completely gone. Town clerk's office completely gone. They're iffy. They're some good, some bad. They're drying them out right now.
No, we preserved all yours.
We had to go in today to get like all this stuff. We should have seen this thing running around. It's not.
Yeah. I fit in. You fit my head in.
Okay, have we got everyone in, or is there more people coming? We're all set. Okay, let's get started. The first thing that you need to know is we follow an outline, and hopefully you've gotten a copy of that as you went in. I'd like to thank everyone for it. I'm going to start with the chairman's discussion of procedure on the first item on the outline. Thank you for attending the public hearing. This is a public hearing, not a hearing in public. We want all of your input. I will make sure that everyone knows when we take public comment on the board or on the outline, and it's listed on that when the public can be added to that. We need everything to be said tonight, but not everyone has to say the same thing. For example, if a point's made in order to expedite things along, I might ask for a show of hands if you support the point that was just made. And that showing of hands is the same thing as you all saying it individually in front of the mic. To make your comment, you'll be coming to the mic over here. Many hearing dates are expected for this. These typically take 2 to 3 to 4 to 5, maybe longer till we get all the answers done. You can be guaranteed that we're not expected to finish tonight. We will finish tonight at 10 o'clock. We've gotten rid of, are done all the other business the board has to do, so we can, we'll do to the typical closing time exactly. Basically, when you come to the mic, state your name and address. Try to summarize your point in 2 to 3 minutes. Also, your point should be just on the part of the outline. If we're talking about traffic, we can talk about traffic. That's fine, but let's not talk about, say, utilities while you're at the mic to talk about traffic. So we try to get one piece done at a time down the outline, however long it takes. And usually at the end of one, I'll ask the board members if we have a consensus on that issue, and we're ready to move to the next one. So you'll see that going along. This open space landscape preservation subdivision has two parts to it. The first thing the planning board has to determine is the number of lots that can be permitted. And our bylaw clearly says that while you can use smaller lots on the landscape open space portion, there can't be more lots than what would be permitted on a conventional subdivision. So the advantage to the developer is that he builds less road because he gets smaller frontage requirements under this bylaw. And the advantage to the town is there's 50% or more is open space. And there's buffer areas potentially around the entire development. This is the preferred type of subdivision that the planning board and the town meeting has required for the last about 20 years. And it's preferred to the point where we insist that all of them come through this portion first. If it gets denied, then there can be a conventional subdivision. But you have to come through the open space subdivision bylaw first. Basically, we are gathering information, determining whether it can be approved or not approved, or whether we need to put any conditions on what we decide to do. And that's what all these particular hearings will be here. If the board approves a special permit for this, and it takes 6 out of 9 members to vote in favor of this, then the developer does all the detailed engineering and submits a definitive subdivision plan. Basically, it's a two-step process. The special permit requires 6 out of the 9 of us, and then the next process is a definitive subdivision with all the engineering. I believe when the writers of this bylaw did it, they didn't want somebody to have to go through all the engineering if the overall concept wasn't going to get approved. So that's why it's a two-step process. So basically, in the hearing today, you're going to be talking about things at a little bit higher level as opposed to worrying about whether it's 8 inches of gravel under the asphalt or 10 inches or whatever, and what the size of the culvert's going to be for stormwater, et cetera. This is kind of a concept portion, and that's the process that we're in now. Okay, I think that's got that. So we'll start with item number 2, which is a project introduction and talking about the features of the site, and this is the applicant and his engineers.
Before we start, a point of order, just for clarification. Can you explain who an abutter and what an abutter is concerning this project?
Is it 300? 300
so,
feet?
Yeah, a butter notification is sent to the property owners within 300 feet of the property boundary lines.
So it's proper that we have a full 9-member board, including Mrs. Shirley.
Well, so that was going to be my next point. It might make some sense for someone to make note that a disclosure was filed at the town clerk's office.
Yeah.
I'm Vincent Cerulli. I live on Chamberlain Street. I do not live within 300 feet, but I have filed with the State Ethics Commission in the event there's any questions or concerns.
just to, which I support, we're all just all on the same page with the audience.
Okay.
They all know me.
The television.
Much everyone here knows.
The television audience as well.
Okay, so, Kathy?
Great. Kathy Sherry from REC Hopkinton. I'm here tonight with Paul Mastriani, the property owner and applicant, as well as members of our team to answer any questions and such. We have Bob Michaud from MDM Transportation, our traffic consultants, Scott Goddard from Goddard Consulting, our wetland specialist. Mark Allen is our civil engineer who developed the plan in conjunction with the landscape architect. He'll be joining us shortly after he attends another hearing. So REC Hopkinton is seeking a special permit for an open space and landscape preservation development for a proposed 34-lot residential subdivision to be located on approximately 83 acres of land between Wayland Road and Chamberlain Street. The land right now is currently undeveloped. There's about 16 acres of wetlands throughout the property. There are intermittent streams. There is a potential vernal pool on the land. It is accessible from both Wayland Road as well as Chamberlain Street. It also abuts land owned by the town, including the school district or the high school, as well as a portion of the land known as Berry Acres. We've submitted to the board for review a concept plan for the subdivision that meets the special permit criteria. We are proposing, as pointed out, to create smaller lots than a conventional subdivision, leaving 42 acres of undeveloped open space. So the project scope would include all the site work to basically construct 34 new, detached single-family dwellings and the accompanying yards, driveways, private septic, private well, and public utilities. We would also have construction of a new public road connecting Chamberlain and Wayland, as well as two cul-de-sacs and improvements to Chamberlain Street. I just want to talk briefly about the number of lots. So in determining the number of allowable lots on the open space plan, we use the guidelines provided. So we looked and developed a conventional subdivision plan that resulted in 35 lots. We then did the next step, which was to use the density calculation that's provided, that resulted in 48 lots. So taking the lesser of the two, our upper threshold for the number of lots on the open space plan was 35. When we actually drafted the conceptual plan, it resulted in 34 lots and 50% open space. This should be sheet 6 of 10 in the site plan if you're looking at it. This is the conventional plan that we've submitted for review. At a very high level, we have 13 residential lots coming off of Wayland Road, 21 residential lots coming off of Chamberlain Street with a new roadway connecting Wayland and Chamberlain. We have about 3,400 feet of new roadway, two cul-de-sacs that meet the requirements under the special permit. Each one is about 230 feet, supporting four house lots. And then we have about what's planned right now for about 500 feet of improvements along the Chamberlain Road area leading up to where the new road would intersect with the existing road. The average lot size is about an acre. We actually go a little bit below an acre up to about an acre and a half. All the area, frontage, and setbacks meet the minimum requirements defined by the bylaws. We have at least 100 feet of foot frontage, if not more, for every lot. The front, side, and rear yard setbacks are minimums or better for each of the lots. We are requesting one waiver, and that's from providing the minimum 100-foot perimeter width buffer zone along just a smaller portion of Chamberlain Road, primarily lots 34 to lot 29. Stormwater management is addressed through the use of retention basins on several of the residential lots. From a conservation perspective, all of our structures are outside of the 100-foot buffer zone. We have no disturbance within a 50-foot buffer zone. We do have two wetland crossings, one over connecting Wayland to the new road and then connecting Wayland to Chamberlain. We do recognize that that will require town, state, and federal approval. With the open space, we have approximately 42 acres that would be preserved as open space and with the intent being deeded to the town. Of the 42 acres, just under 27 acres are uplands. So over 63% are uplands with a smaller portion wetlands within the open space. The open space plan does preserve the intermittent streams, the vernal pool, and the associated wetlands and buffer areas within the property. There are trails that currently go through the property, and the intent would be for us to relocate and or extend the trail system so that it would still connect and now go through the open space areas. That's the site plan at a high level. Due to the concerns about the road connection between Chamberlain and Wayland, we did initiate a traffic study that MDM submitted along with our application and has been reviewed and such. The overall findings of the study, and we'll discuss it in detail tonight, was that the trip generation for the development was expected to be modest, and we didn't have a significant or material impact on the operating conditions at the various intersections. Additionally, we presented and submitted two alternate site plans showing an emergency access only connection between Wayland and Chamberlain, and one with no connection and just two cul-de-sacs for a more detailed discussion in this level of forum. That's high level overview.
I have one question. The open, the office park parcel, that is not part of the open space calculation?
It is not. So we had originally submitted and we subsequently amended it. So basically it's the 83 acres out of the a little over 100 acres that Mr. Mastriani owns. We've excluded the 18 acres of office park. So this section right down here is not included in what we're discussing or any of the numbers or percentages that we've presented in our application or tonight.
But to that point, through the chair,
The lots 8, 7, and 6 are up against the wetland in the office space itself. Is that correct?
Well, for that matter, 9, 10, and 11.
This would be the zoning line, so there's still a 100-foot buffer between that zoning line and the start of the lot, if that's what you're asking.
Well, no, just the wetland itself goes into quite a bit into lot 8, lot 7, and into 6. Is that correct?
I don't see it in 7, Cliff.
No, I don't see that.
Or 8, I think it's out of those.
There is more of it in 9 and 10. You can see where the wetland is extending.
Are you on page 6?
Okay, so I'm on 3 of 10.
Six of ten.
Yeah, but I'm on 3 of 10. I see the layout here.
That would be the conventional plan, I believe.
Yeah.
So if that's just there to determine the number of lots, this is not a proposed plan.
Right.
Okay, so then I move to 6 of 10.
Yes.
Yeah. What's the debt? What are you going to do with the office park? Block.
We do not know.
Okay. Other questions of the board members?
Well, back to that point. So we have some issues with the wetland crossing roads that are projected in several areas, and then we have encroachment on wetland with the lots 11, 10, and 9.
You can have wetlands on a lot.
I understand, but
okay.
The most concern that I have with this whole project, just right off the bat, is my concern for septic systems that are going to leach off into the wetland. That is a very big concern of mine for anyone and everyone. So to that point, I want to bring that up right off the bat because that's where I'm going to make my stance and hope that there's some resolve to understanding
the best solution for the wetlands.
So through Mr. Chair, just we have that identified as 7F for the, when the details, when we get to that 7F.
Do you want to wait for us?
Would you like to speak to that now or later?
Well, we'll talk about it later.
Okay, very good.
Yeah.
So just one comment, Mr. Chair, just a follow-on question. You were asking about the office park land. I understand that you don't know what you're doing with it, but if you were to do something with it, where would the access come in from?
We do not have any access right
okay.
now for that. So I just
thought maybe you had an idea. Thank you. I just wanted to ask a question.
It abuts the Muse.
I mean, the only abutters that are not him or the open space is NSTAR and Simone.
It does abut the Muse. It abuts the Muse.
Yeah, so the Muse, but you can't get from the Muse to there, I don't think.
Well, you can. There's a small well crossing.
Okay.
Never say never.
Helicopter.
Okay. Yes.
If they don't talk over there, we can't hear them.
Okay.
Kathy's going to have to answer all the questions.
They can each come up here.
Okay.
Does this move?
Other questions by planning board members? I think we're on item number three then. Jennifer?
So I don't have a lot of comments at the moment. Probably not. I've been busy the last couple of days trying to just get organized. But we did have a staff meeting last week, internal staff meeting with all the various departments, and a lot of those comments were in my memo. Overall, though, generally, they felt they didn't have a lot of information because it's such a concept plan, and a lot of them were reserving comments until they could get more detailed information, which I think is to be expected. But there are some there is some good information here that we should consider. And the other thing just to point out is that they will also need a flexible community development special permit, which they're aware of, that they have not applied for yet. But they indicate that they will do that at some point. So it's another special permit that they will need for their affordable housing piece of the project. Other than that, at this time, I don't have any comments until we have more detailed drawings and I can review them.
Okay. Any questions of Jennifer?
Question.
Yeah.
You just mentioned something about an affordable housing piece. Is that required?
We have a bylaw that requires any development of 10 lots or more to file for a flexible community development, which requires an affordable housing lot for every 10 units. And that's either the board's discretion to construct the affordable housing unit or to do a payment in lieu of at this board's discretion. They can request the payment in lieu of, but it's your choice.
And that typically is an application, and I think most likely, because they're not sure exactly how many lots it is, it's kind of hard to go forward with that. Mm-hmm. I mean, that's something that will require, obviously, but as part of the next phase of the definitive plan for sure.
Yep.
But it's also, is that a special permit?
It is a special permit.
So it is another six votes, so it's another bite at the apple. Some people do it at the same time because if they're going to get one approval, they'll get the other approval.
Right.
Usually, that's a philosophy. And if you might remember last meeting, we did a analysis of our build out for 2020, so that we know where we would go. Okay, Phil, do you want to come up and give some beta overview?
For the record, Phil Paradis with Beta Group. With me today is Mike Wazowski, who reviewed the traffic with Beta Group as well. So I'll address the site plan. Again, as was mentioned before, this is a very concept plan. Many of the aspects.
Just to clarify so people know that Beta is the town's consultant and not the applicant's consultant.
Okay.
Thank you. And so the project is a very concept level, and so we reviewed it based on what's required relative to lot sizing, location, and some of those issues was already. One of the issues that we see was as part of the conventional subdivision plan. We might have an issue with kind of where the road layout was based on wetland impacts. It appears as though this road could be relocated to reduce the wetland impacts and possibly impact the number of lots. We don't know that. There's also it's a fairly substantial wetland impact that will require some consideration of the Conservation Commission and DEP and such. It appears as though they would exceed the 5,000 square foot threshold relative to projects, and this is also contiguous to the previous project they had before the board. So all those issues relative to wetland impacts will need to be addressed. The board also should consider the buffer zone impacts and also the fact that they're anticipating doing some work on Chamberlain Street, this portion is just a gravel drive right now. The portion from here, some distance back, is a, I want to say, a driveway level, 13-foot wide roadway. So that would also have to be expanded to allow for at least two-way traffic to get to and from these roadways. And I just want to raise the issue that, one of the issues that the... No, I'll hold on off one. So basically the lots, we checked all the lot frontage and all the requirements for sizing and stuff, and they meet all those issues. But these are the issues relative to stormwater. We don't have any details, so we didn't evaluate that. We assume that it can be engineered to work. And some of the septic systems will need to be vetted in terms of there was no soils data given to understand if that's possible, and obviously wells and such. But
okay,
sure. I'll pass it off to Mike to talk about traffic issues.
Okay, sure.
Thanks, Phil. Mike Wasileski with the Beta Group. I reviewed the traffic memorandum that was generated for the project. The proponent performed intersection capacity analysis at four intersections. That is Hayden Row Street at Chamberlain, Hayden Row and Grove Street at Pleasant, Main at Pleasant, and West Main Street at Whalen Road. They analyzed conditions during the weekday, morning, and afternoon peak hours. They conducted traffic counts at all four intersections during these periods. They set a baseline. They performed some trip generation calculations based on the Institute of Transportation Engineer standards. We reviewed those calculations. They were all in line with industry standards. They then applied that traffic to the existing volume network and performed a future analysis of traffic conditions. And their analysis shows that the additional traffic generated by the development will not significantly increase delays at the studied intersections. They also did an analysis of travel time between the intersection of Whalen Road and West Main Street and Hayden Row Street and Chamberlain Street to see what that travel time is in each direction during the morning 2-hour period and during the 2-hour afternoon period to evaluate the potential for cut-through traffic using the new connection once you connect Whalen Road to Chamberlain Street. Their conclusion was that the travel time on the existing route is shorter than the travel time that would be experienced on the proposed route. We've taken a look at that, and we don't exactly agree with that, so I think that's something that should be discussed further, and that probably would be in Section 7D, I would think. Mm-hmm. We did have a number of questions for the proponent. They provided additional information, and that satisfied our questions. So the only one that I think we still have open is looking at the cut-through potential of the new roadway.
At this time, we also, the planning board also retained another firm, World Tech. World Tech is the engineering firm that's looking at the Hayden Row corridor at this point. And so we gave them a very limited aspect to look at. One was cut through time and look at the Hayden Row, Chamberlain Street, site conditions, et cetera. So we have their full report. They're not here tonight. I got a note here from Jennifer. Going back a little bit, does the fire department, because you guys are here today, do you have something you want to say today at the introductory portion, or you?
Not at this time, Ken.
Okay, thank you. Okay, the next, so we're, are any questions from of Beta from members of the board at a high level?
Just one question, Ken.
Yep.
I noticed that nothing was mentioned about the intersection of Hayden Row and Granite and Lumber and West Main. Doesn't seem like that was studied, and I do believe that cars going that route could potentially use the Teresa to Chamberlain or Chamberlain direct to Wayland.
Well, we'll get into all the details during the traffic aspect of it. Okay, now we're on to item number five. Number five is where everyone can add to the outline. This is kind of a brainstorming thing. You can add to the outline by saying, I'd like to talk about whatever. As long as it's not on a list, we'll probably add it to the list. But it's a brainstorming. We don't need a long discussion. If there's any representative of the group that wants to kind of give an overview, you can talk about more than one thing that you want to add to the outline at this point. This is just so we get organized for tonight or for future meetings of adding on to the outline. Carol.
Can you hear me from here?
No, we got to get over here, unfortunately.
Okay, I'm not a leader of anything. I'm just here speaking on my own behalf.
Okay.
But I would
Name and address.
Carol DeVere, 47 Chamberlain Street. And I would like to talk about the wetlands impacts and the resource area impacts on Chamberlain Street that are going to be impacted by this development. And I would like them to be included in the overall impacts of the project.
Okay, we'll add that as part of 7A.
Thank you.
Could I ask a question?
Yep.
Yep. Through the chair?
Yep.
Carol, can you explain how many years of a planning board experience you've had?
Five.
Thank you.
Okay.
Hi, Gary Trendle, 31 Chamberlain Street. I've got two questions. One, I think the board did a great job with the new master plan. I'm curious as to at what point you will evaluate this proposal with its alignment with the new master plan. I'm not sure quite where that fits in, but. And then my second question is specific to safety. And I guess I'm thinking more about pedestrian safety, bicycle safety. Not quite sure where that fits in.
It might fit in under traffic D, sidewalks.
Okay.
But maybe not. We'll add an E called bicycle.
And then also, I just wanted to make one comment. You know, a lot of people in the community opted to send letters to the planning board. I think they're people that care very strongly about this. And it was a little disappointing to see that they were not included in the packet. You know, people, they got them in time. The packet was 371 pages. I think there were 24 letters. And you know, I just to put them in a Google Drive and access that when they're not part of the packet, I think it just sort of sends the bad message to the community that decided to write letters on behalf of their concerns.
I know I read every one that was forwarded to me, so.
Great.
I thought, did other members get those letters?
I read everyone.
From the Google?
Yeah,
okay. Board members look like they've read them.
Okay, that's great then.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Hi, I'm Amanda Fauché. I live at 39 Chamberlain Street, and I'm also the co-chair for the Chamberlain Wayland Neighborhood Coalition Group, and it's comprised of over 100 residents of Chamberlain Street, Wayland Street, and the surrounding neighborhoods. This coalition came together in a response to this proposal to build this large subdivision on a road that would connect Chamberlain and Wayland Road. Our immediate objective to getting this coalition going was to preserve our neighborhood's characteristics and help facilitate a plan that would work for all the parties. We also started a online petition that garnered 500, it's really thick, 500 signatures of other residents also who are concerned about this proposal and subdivision and perhaps further development in Hopkinton that might need a different meeting. But there's also a big social media aspect to this. A lot of people have been commenting on social media about it. There's also talk around town. So it's not just an issue that's in our backyard. It's part of a larger issue. And Gary mentioned the master plan, which I've read too, and it's really a wonderful plan. I know you all spent a lot of time with it, and I'm hoping that master plan works in your thoughts and minds when you're thinking about this development, because there are things in there that speak specifically to this issue. There says there are numerous cul-de-sacs in Hopkinton thought to encourage neighborhood identity, provide privacy, and separate residents from through traffic. Encourage new growth and redevelopment consistent with our values and desires to protect unique features of our town, protect open spaces and natural resources, build upon the town's history and cultural heritage, treasure our beautiful and special places as they define our community, identity, and character. And just as a personal note, on Chamberlain, we just moved there in May, and we had looked a long time for a neighborhood that was close-knit and that our kids could ride their bikes on without any issues. And this neighborhood from the beginning was that neighborhood. The kids ride their bikes, they play in the street, the neighborhoods know each other, there's cookouts and people walk up and down the street, there are joggers, not even just from our neighborhood. If that cut through occurs, that will all go away because the traffic will be speeding down Chamberlain and speeding down Wayland because they are straight streets. And our neighborhood will be changed drastically for the worse. At the end of Chamberlain, it's like he said, it's a narrow, almost like a driveway. And so that will have to be widened, getting rid of scenic rock walls, 100-year-old trees, and Chamberlain itself is designated as a scenic road. So I don't know how there could be any tearing apart of Chamberlain to get this cut through because it's a designated scenic road. So I hope that the planning board thinks a little bit about it and not just rubber stamps it through. Thank you.
Good evening, Don Caveney, 14 Wayland Road. I'm the co-chair with Amanda, representing kind of the Wayland Road group. I'm here kind of individually as well as representing Wayland Road. And I just, Ken, to your point about big picture questions, my big picture is I'm an attorney by trade, but I don't do a lot of land use work, and I'm trying to get a grasp of this open space plan and how it works with the conventional plan. Because looking at Beta's six-page response to the plan, there seems to be significant wetlands issues. And if they're already over 5,000 on the conventional, Is CONCOM even going to permit a conventional plan to go forward? And if CONCOM doesn't permit a conventional plan to go forward, can the open space plan go forward? So I'm struggling with understanding why we're here talking about a kind of a modified conceptual plan when there seems to be a heck of a lot of information that's needed for this board to make a decision as to whether or not this wetland issue can be overcome by the developer. And I am not, and I think everyone on Whalen Road that I talk to, everyone on Chamberlain I talk to, we're not NIMBYs. We are not in our backyard people. But we just want something, if something's gonna be done, that it's done in accordance with what the bylaws permit and what the environmental regulations permit.
Right.
And I'll just wrap it up real quick. It's just, again, I just look at the beta response, and it's 5,000 square feet already, and I don't think that addresses what was done with Hopkinton Mews, and Hopkinton Mews was a significant crossing. So I don't understand why we're here on a conceptual thing when there's so much more that needs to be done in order to make a determination as to whether or not this thing goes forward.
The only answer I'm going to give you is 7A, which is the top of our list, is asking for just about everything you just mentioned for.
Okay.
What we'll be
discussing. I look forward to 7A then.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Yeah. Other items that we might have missed on the outline.
Point of order, Ken.
Yeah.
Concerning that comment, why are we here? We mentioned this at our last meeting, and some other people have asked me in privately. There are only four meetings before the next election, and we need six votes. And as we mentioned at our last meeting, Ken said if we don't meet this time frame, basically we'd have to start over again, which is the risk of the applicant. So we may be here now, but we may be here again after the election as well. So keep that in mind.
Brian?
Hi, Brian Hurt, Elizabeth Road. I'm just a little confused. I got here late. My apologies. But the plan, the packet that you folks have in front of you, is that with one plan or three plans?
There's actually three plans. There's the conceptual that we need to determine the number of lots. There's the proposal, and he actually has two alternates in there.
So what is the public hearing addressing in terms of which plan is the public hearing going to focus on?
Right now we're looking at everything, all four of those. The conventional we have to look at to determine the number of lots. We have the applicant's proposal, and after having seen that, when Jennifer and I looked at that, we also suggested very on in the process that he might want to think about alternates.
It just seems to me that the connection of the roads is one of the big concerns that a lot of people share.
And that's right there at 7C in our outline. We will be talking about that shortly.
Okay. Because if you go through the whole connected road scenario, but you're going to a two cul-de-sac scenario, you're going to spend a lot of time and energy just going through the
I
motions.
I understand. I mean, the board has to evaluate what is in front of us. The fact that we've looked at
We have three plans in this application.
Well, we have what he submitted, and I think that there might be an alternate that would probably work better.
Okay. Thank you.
If I can't throw the chair down.
But that's just one person looking at it, and that's why it's there.
I agree with Ken's viewpoint, though, about the multiple. It's a concept, and we're looking at it from different angles and finding some happy solution. You've been on the planning board before, Mr. Hurt, right?
Yes.
So maybe the process is a little bit different from when you were on the board, or like, what is your suggestion?
I don't think so.
No? Okay.
That's the point. Thank you.
Other items? Please.
Hello, name is Irfan Nasrullah, 211 Winter Street. I'm an attorney in town, practicing environmental real estate law. I note that all the lots have a well and septic system on them, and I would note that would be considered nitrogen sensitive. I'm curious as to whether or not any of the open space is going to be used as credit land in a nitrogen aggregation plan, or whether or not there's going to be limits on the number of bedrooms.
So adding to this would be septic and bedroom limits. Okay.
Hi. Margie Wigan, 5 Cross Street. I just have a kind of a global question, which is that I think, I don't know if there's a place in here where you could talk about the percentage of land that's been developed in recent years, and if there is a plan for, are we going to develop all of our land? Or are we just looking, you know, if we just look at each individual property, and I think Paul has a great plan and a great property. I'm not sure it should happen because of the neighborhood. But I think if we just look at each plan individually, and we're not looking at the big picture, which is that every development that we put in, whether it's legacy or whichever thing it is, takes away from the open land that we have and that we value and the quality of our neighborhoods. So could you discuss or add into the outline a discussion of the general plan? Is there a general plan for percentage of development in Hopkinton?
I think that's out of the bounds of this particular hearing.
Okay.
I would suggest you reread the master plan because that's the closest you're going to get to that. And okay. I think it's kind of individual property rights where, you know, he has some property rights because he owns the land, and
right,
and the neighbors have property rights, et cetera, because yep. they own the land. And,
okay.
And, you know, there's the open space committee that John chairs. You know, they talk about what land they want to buy. CPC yep. does, but I won't say we're reactive, but we react to proposals. I mean, we don't try to buy land adversely, usually.
Right, I just didn't know if there were, and as you say, it's probably in the master plan. It just seems that there is so much development happening at a fast pace, and I was hoping
you can blame that on the good school system.
Well, you're welcome, Linda. All right.
Does anyone else want to add? Oh, go ahead.
Mary Arnott, 51 Teresa Road. I think this is going to be in my backyard if it goes through, but if looking for items to add, not to be too short-sighted, if I didn't understand this, I'd like to know this office park land, if this subdivision goes through, and then they want to put an office park in here too, where even just conceptually, where would they see access to it? What would be the impact of that? What kind of things would go in there? Because I think that you have to consider the entire piece of property when you're making a decision on this. So I would add that to the outline if you could.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, go ahead.
Hi, I'm Anthony Huntington at 18 Chamberlain Street. I just had a question, or if something that could be asked during the traffic part of this discussion as to if there was any estimation of the increased traffic from the school that will be opening at the near the intersection of Hayden and Chamberlain. It doesn't exactly affect this project per se, but it will be a factor, certainly, in the future. And I would think, based on traffic you could study around Center School, you could add an estimation how it would impact on this our road.
I believe that was included in the traffic studies, so
it wasn't mentioned specifically. So
we will make it that part of the discussion.
Thank you,
okay. Mr. Chairman. Just to piggyback on that comment, just maybe on the outlines, and I can see it here somewhere around school and bus impact, right? Number of students, increased number of students as a result, and any type of bus route impact.
Okay.
Amy Ritterbush, 54 Grove Street. I had a question about, or I'd like you to add to the discussion, the downtown corridor project, which I know does not extend as far as Wayland, but it comes pretty close to Wayland. And the impact of people who would be coming from Chamberlain through Wayland and might want to turn left onto West Main. And I assume that Wayland is too close, the intersection is too close to the intersection of West Main and Wood, that you wouldn't be able to put another traffic light in there. So I just wanted to make sure the impacts from the downtown corridor project were being studied in conjunction with this, the impact of this development.
Okay, no, it's, I think it's in the general traffic aspect of it. I think we cover it there.
Hi, Patrick Fauché, 39 Chamberlain. In regards to the road improvement, I just want to make sure that this is included in the discussion. If there's going to be widening of Chamberlain, because it is narrow at spots, including in front of our property, what, if anything, would be done to the abutting properties of that road? If it has to be widened and there's wetlands on the other side, would that cut into the property of those residents? To what extent? What recourse is there?
Okay, let me maybe answer. The town has no intention to take any private land to help support this. However, that section of Chamberlain would probably have to be widened to, because for him to get any occupancy permits on that portion, I believe the fire department requires 20 feet width on the road. So the part that's 13 feet will have to have another 7 feet one way or the other.
Again, my question would be, does that require property to be, I don't know if it's taken is the right word, but will that?
The town has no intention of taking anyone's property, period.
But you said.
What?
So, one of the concerns about the situation in that area is also that speeding, and we don't have an answer yet. So when you're asking us a question, we really can't give you an answer. And
I'm not asking for an answer,
but
just the discussion.
One thing that's I have a preference for is that road calming features like a tighter road at that end of the street would be helpful to have people drive slower. But it's something that we don't have in front of us yet. We have nothing. There's no specific plans, but there are some preferences that we need to work out with the developer, with the neighbors, and there's nothing set in stone.
Great.
Mr. Chairman, so if the fire department's going to require 20 feet of width on Chamberlain and there's currently 13, can we see a plan that shows where that 7 feet is coming from?
That might be something that we will request in the future, yes.
Great,
but
thank you.
To the gentleman's point, we do have a specific line item for the widening of Chamberlain on section 7.
Right, and then one final point. I just want to respond to Ken's point on what this planning board does, and it's the result of a good school system, and that the board reviews plans and assures bylaws. I just want to point out that it's actually specific in the plan that the responsibility of this board isn't simply to react to plans, review them for compliance, and approve them. It is the explicit mandate of this board to actually proactively support the vision that's stated in the charter through proactive action of soliciting plans, working with developers, and working with residents to come up with a plan that actually gets us to that vision. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, just that. Just one quick comment to that comment, but there is previous evidence of exactly that with the exclusion of garden apartments going forward. So the board does do not just what is brought before them, but definitely proactive things. And that's just one of the ones that just came to my mind quickly.
John Fitzgerald, 46 Chamberlain Street. Follow up to Patrick's question. If Chamberlain Street does change and there is some widening, has this board considered the effects on those houses that if the road is widened, would it change a house if the road is widened, would it change the use of that house? Would it still fall under certain guidelines the town has for frontage, driveways?
Yes, it would. Everything would be the same. We're not going to take.
I'm not saying you're taking.
Then we're not changing anything. Anything that is outside in the public right of way. You know, the public right of way. I'm not sure how wide it is. It's probably 40 feet there. You don't own just
up to the side of the curb. The public right-of-way is the public right-of-way.
So the public, so nothing would change to the public right-of-way. So the house that's on that lot where it's the public right-of-way, whether they lose, well, they're not losing because you're saying it's the town's land, correct?
Well, if it's a part of the public right-of-way, it is the town's land, yes.
Okay, so nothing would change on that person's property in terms of
absolutely not
usage.
Right.
Okay. Yeah, thank you.
Mr. Chairman, just a point of order. It sounds like we're getting into the details and not we've gotten away from adding items to the outline.
Okay.
Hi, thank you, Mr. Chair. Joe Markey, 39 Ash Street. I have an item that I don't really see explicitly enough on the list here under item 7. You do have something about trails. It says basically it's a subcategory under remaining land, open space, kind of what's left over, making sure there's some trail connections. But if you look at these plans, that nice dotted dashed line you see throughout, there's an extensive trail network through this property, through these properties today. And through in the master plan you just looked at earlier today, preservation of trails is a key priority for the town. I just hope that the planning board takes seriously that item as they look at this and other plans, because we've seen this happen on other developments as well, where we get kind of soft commitment on working some trails in there, and it doesn't happen. And we stand to lose a huge, valuable resource that's so I hope you take seriously
we got it on the agenda, so we will talk about it in detail.
I don't see it on the agenda. It says trail connections and what's left over, but I would like to see preservation of trails. Thank you.
Okay. Through the chair, Mr. Markey, I asked this question of all the past planning board members. How many years have you been on the planning board previously? You were served for 10 years or 5? I'm trying to illustrate the depth of planning board experience that's speaking.
I was on the planning board for 5 years. One of the key projects was the Legacy Farm zoning. That's an example of where we had a great mixed-use plan, smart growth, that got eroded over the years. Yeah, due to behavior of the town boards and even town meeting of trying to bend over backwards to accommodate developers. That isn't always in the best interest of the town. So that's a little bit of my perspective. Thank you.
And there's actually a few more in the audience too, so.
I think we're all set with the outline. I don't see anyone else wants to go to the mic on that. Okay, the next thing on our outline is to schedule a site walk. The weather looks good for the Saturday. Does anyone on the board want to do a Saturday site walk? Whether people are interested? Well, maybe we do it, the following weekend?
Morning's better. I think Saturday morning has worked well for us in the past, right?
Yep. Right. So we're looking for, who's got a calendar
out? The
22nd.
What time? So I can just, it will not be a public meeting, but I'll have to post it if you're going to be a quorum.
Yep.
So what time?
9, maybe we do 9. Or
should
it's
we do
Earth
9?
Day as well.
9 a.m.? Good.
Sure. Appropriate.
9 a.m. and we will meet. Where's the best place to meet to walk in?
I'd say probably on the Chamberlain Street. Chamberlain.
Okay. Okay, the site walk is a public is all invited. It is just a walk. It's just an opportunity for the planning board members to kind of walk through there and see the site on the ground. There might be a few questions kind of asked, but it's not part of the public record per se. It's an informal look-see. Obviously things that are obvious that we note, we'll look to go see. And if anyone has any items that they would like us to make sure we go see, kind of point those out eventually. So 9 a.m. Chamberlain End.
Wear comfortable clothes and shoes.
Yeah.
Takes
about an hour, Ken? Hour and a half, you think?
Yeah, I'm hoping we'll do that. Okay, Now we're in the detailed discussion, and public comment will be invited on each item as we go through it. And the first item that we're talking about is the Conservation Commission filing. And this is a discussion of the Conservation Commission input that is desired by the Planning Board. And I'm going to start it out with three or four things that I think we need to ask them for. And I believe they're on the meeting next. The first item is...
These are things you want Conservation Commission?
We'll draft a letter to Conservation Commission so they understand where we're at. First thing, talking about the 5,000 square feet, where are they on that? You know, that's kind of I won't say an accounting aspect, but when you get close to 5,000 square feet, things change. Second of all, I think we want them to look at the conventional layout, which has got 5 wetland crossings. Is that something they would approve or not? The next one is the submittal, which is, I'll call it the connecting road aspect of it. I think we need to have them look at the emergency access plan with our cul-de-sac rule that we've enforced over the years. We might be able to tweak that with the emergency access, which would be a 20-foot connection across the two cul-de-sacs. And then the last one, I think, is the Chamberlain wetland impact on the widening of Chamberlain. And I think those are the things that we need to ask Conservation Commission.
Can I add to that?
Sure.
With regards to the Chamberlain wetland, I think that there's a greater aspect to wetland in general across the board. And I think that as we're seeing here tonight, a lot of people are reflecting on that aspect of this project. That would be inclusive of Title V septics versus an alternative and so forth, and wells that are being impacted. So I really think that this should be looked at in depth for everyone involved across the board as a strong point of what we need CONCOM to take a look at.
I think the overall bit, the 5,000 square feet kind of gets, that's another way of approaching that same question,
sure.
Cliff, because
sure.
That's why they have the 5,000 foot rule, meaning that if you're impacting less than 5,000 square feet, that's one level, and once you get to 5,001, you get to another level, I guess. So, but.
Through the chair.
Yeah, cool.
And I think one thing to touch on is maybe look at some of the other parcels that, such as this office park land and your other undeveloped, and get a picture of that and what the wetlands are. Because instead of just looking at what's been developed and the impact on the wetlands, knowing that you have other pieces of property that you might come back and need something done on that, I think for everybody to look at it, it has to be the entire picture.
If I can make a comment about this, I attended the Conservation Commission's meeting, part of it, on the 27th after our meeting, so I missed some of the details, but it's my understanding that the scientist team that they have are underway in taking their measurements, and Phil Paradis is also involved in some of that, and I think we're in good hands in that regard, and I look forward to seeing more of their findings.
I mean, it's key for what Conservation Commission says can and cannot be done on this.
Yes.
I mean, yes, Fran.
Mr. Chairman, does CONCOM also look at the trail network, existing trail network, or is that out of their scope?
If it's particularly outside the wetlands areas, it would be outside of their scope.
Okay.
Well, one thing that is, I have a concern, and maybe I'll save it until we get to the wetlands part of it, but I'll throw it out there now.
we're talking about the office park area, and I don't think the Concom, and I wouldn't be too happy with any plan that doesn't include space to get to the office park, because of making a wetlands crossing after the fact when we have time to plan it now, doesn't make sense. So it's better to plan it now.
Mr. Chairman, point of, I don't know if it's a point of order, but I don't think as part of this plan, we can assume or try to guess at what's going to happen in the future. You would know better than I would how we're supposed to attack these things, but I would think we have to look at what's laid in front of us and not try to determine what's going to happen with another piece of land that's not part of this.
In all regards, this is the land and it's right in front of you.
Well, it's probably that last parcel of the office park is probably going to be stranded as an open space aspect. It's landlocked. I'm not sure that, you know, besides, I don't think you can get to it ever with the wetland aspect of it. It'll probably end up being either.
I can't get to it.
Mr. Chair?
Yeah.
There was a point where we said that this parcel of land was landlocked.
Yes.
This part.
What we're looking at now, we said at one point this was landlocked and that he didn't have access to it. Because he didn't. He didn't have a right-of-way. He didn't have an access to get to Wayland
Street. So we could have done a cul-de-sac. So it wasn't ever landlocked.
Okay. Right.
Yeah. Okay, well, I think, is there any public comment on what anyone else thinks that we need to get from the wetlands, or do you have a response?
I can make a couple of brief comments. My name is Scott Goddard from Goddard Consulting. I'm a professional wetland scientist and own my own consulting firm. I've been doing this work for over 20 years and have filed thousands of applications with conservation commissions. As Frank and others know, that I've been before the Hopkinton Conservation Commission on many projects. This is a project that does include wetland impacts. There's no question about that. But there seems to be a lot of discussion about 5,000 square feet and all. What you can know is this. We are going before the Hopkinton Conservation Commission on April 24th for an informal discussion, and the purpose of that is to receive feedback from them on this application so that they can inform the planning board better as to their position about this project. We are not intending on getting a full permit from them for the conventional development, but simply an opinion about the potential feasibility of permittability or approvability of that project. So in other words, we're not asking them to say, yes, we are approving this project, but could they or do they have the authority to grant approval for that project? And what they know and what I know is that the 5,000 square foot rule is not a magic number that can never be surpassed, right? So we can certainly permit activities greater than 5,000 square feet under certain provisions of the Massachusetts Wetland Protection Act, as well as Hopkinton's Wetland Protection Bylaw. As the chairman pointed out, it does have a higher threshold of permitting review, and additional permits are required, but it is not a barrier that we cannot hop over. We do have to demonstrate to the Conservation Commission, however, that we've done everything in our power to minimize the wetland impacts. And part of that comes directly from the feedback of the Planning Board. In fact, the wetland regulations under 310 CMR 1053 for limited crossing projects require us to have the minimum acceptable width of a road allowable by the planning board. So the wetland regulations cite the planning board as the authority that dictates the amount of wetlands. So our preference, in order of preference from the wetlands perspective, is to do the cul-de-sacs with no wetland crossing in the center, which would greatly reduce our wetland impacts. That would be our first point of preference from the Conservation Commission's perspective and the wetlands perspective. The next one, if that was unacceptable to the planning board, would be the reduced width crossing through the center of the wetland. And then the last option, which I still believe would be a permittable option if the planning board did not allow something of a lesser impact, would be the full-blown road from Chamberlain through onto Wayland Road. So I believe, based on the feedback of this board, will drive the review process of the Conservation Commission. So this is sort of a two-pronged approach, right? The planning board wants feedback from the CONCOM, but the CONCOM is dependent somewhat on the feedback from the planning board. So if I can report to the Conservation Commission that the planning board sees the cul-de-sac approach or the reduced width emergency access road as a more favorable goal, that can then inform our approach to the Conservation Commission that we've made every effort possible to minimize the wetland impacts. But I'm confident that any version of these projects is permissible with the wetland regulations as they stand today, both locally, federally, and at the Massachusetts state level.
Great. Let me respond to your question, because there's a good point there. First of all, I think you ought to use a 20-foot wide roadway for all areas. We have feedback in our package from the fire department that the emergency access has to be 20 feet. So it won't be as reduced as it is. We'll talk a little bit about layout, design, and concept plan, but for this, let's just use an assumption that you've got the plan that you submitted, obviously the conventional that we need to determine the lots from, and then use the one with the emergency access at 20 feet when you go before. Those are the ones that I think we're interested in hearing. We have a long policy about not permitting long cul-de-sacs in town. I've had it for 20-something years. If you want to see development creep all over town, just change that policy, because that takes every 10-acre lot and makes it into 3 and 4 different lots.
Can I just say, it's not a policy, it's a regulation.
It's a regulation. Thank you. Okay.
It's a little different.
It's in the regulation. Okay. So basically, one of the other benefits of the open space portion is that small cul-de-sacs are allowed as part of it, as opposed to a conventional does not, unless there are exceptional circumstances, and you've all had that memo. But
there was also a comment, if I could, about the septic systems and the impacts on wetlands and all. So the septic systems, as they would be designed, would be all greater than 100 feet away from the septics, from the wetlands, where state Title V requirements is only 50 feet away. So we're actually double the distance for any septic systems on this site, which would produce greater wetland protection.
To that statement, does that include the leaching fields that go along with the septic systems?
Correct. That is the leaching fields, in fact, yes.
Okay.
Tanks and fields.
Yeah. Thank you.
I have two comments on this topic. One is the planning aspects based on feedback from us to the Conservation Commission is important, but I think what the chair is asking now is for what information do we need? What science are we looking for that the Conservation Commission can share with us in regards to what their findings are on that property, because that will drive what's possible to be done.
Well, correct me if I'm wrong, but I'm not sure we want to get into the wetland science level of this project's impacts at this board. Rather, present that to the Conservation Commission.
That's exactly. They will give us that feedback,
right?
Yeah.
So I'll be presenting at a more scientific, technical level at the Conservation Commission to demonstrate the feasibility of this project. But then the feedback will come back to you. But I would like to represent to them that there's a mutual goal of the town boards in order to minimize the wetland impacts. The abutters want to minimize wetland impacts, from what I can hear. You know, the applicant wants to minimize wetland impacts. The Conservation Commission certainly does, and I presume that the board here has some interest in that as well. So if I can present that to the Conservation Commission, that there's a sort of an overarching goal of wetland impact minimization, I think that will facilitate our discussion in all capacities.
I don't think we have a problem with minimizing wetlands. We're just saying from a minimum road width, it's 20 feet.
Understood.
You know, I mean, that's...
And that's good information. Thank you.
So, Mr. Chairman, are there three options that would be going in front of CONCOM? The conventional?
Yeah.
The one with the 20-foot connecting of the two cul-de-sacs? And the third option where there'd be no connection? That's what I heard him say.
No. It would be the two cul-de-sacs with the connecting emergency access route. Only, no through traffic.
Right. So just those two options, like conventional and that one.
And are you looking for their feedback on the permittability of the conventional straight up, or
yes,
and stopping there, or further feedback on the other plans as well?
Well, we need all of those is what we're going to be asking for.
If they that's not permittable, then I don't think we can move forward.
Understood, and that's why I asked the question, because if we have to answer that first question first, which is the conventional permittable, reasonably so as such, then we don't have to answer the subsequent questions, right? So, but if we can demonstrate that the conventional is permittable from the Conservation Commission's perspective, then the feedback on the subsequent plans becomes more pertinent.
Right.
Yeah. I mean, if they would approve the conventional with its five crossings, then presumably they would approve the two crossings that are in the other plan.
And certainly we're not going to present to them enough information to say, yes, that plan we would approve,
right.
But it's going to have to be something short of that, right? Because that would require a full design and application. It would be that project has a regulatory avenue by which it could be approved, so if the board so chose.
You have to, I'm sorry, if you're speaking, you have to stand at the mic.
I do have to depart for another meeting. So is there any last minute questions to me before Mr. Allen?
I do have one more comment. You mentioned that you're doing that on the 24th of April.
Yes.
Timing-wise, we're also meeting the 24th of April. And so maybe our next meeting is May 8th, something like that. That's like one more meeting before the election, so I'm
trying to go on the 24th also.
Dual?
Yeah.
We're a little bit challenged with meeting space as of today.
Yeah.
All right, it's up to you.
Good evening. My name is Mark Allen, Allen Engineering, Civil Engineering, Land Development Consultant for Mr. Mastriani. For the entire 200 acres that has been under development over the last 4 or 5 years. My question or point that Francis brought up is, would you want the Conservation Commission to also at least weigh in on their viability of the absolute no connection and just have two cul-de-sacs at either end of the wetland?
No, because that's nothing that we would permit.
Okay, fair.
Yes, Carol.
Can I just ask a question? Why are you absolutely refusing to consider that as an option? Is it a public safety issue?
Up to the mic, please.
I'm just trying to understand why you are absolutely refusing to consider two dead ends without a connector. Is that a public safety issue or?
It is two things. And we were going to talk about a little bit further down the outline in greater detail. But basically, it is a public safety. It's beyond what our rules and regulations are. Where am I supposed to? Dead ends.
First one, I think, says shall not be permitted.
Dead ends shall not be approved except where exceptional circumstances exist in the opinion of the board. Exceptional circumstances may serve severe environmental which render a through road detrimental to the environment when a through road complies with all other state and regulations, including wetlands regulations, open space, and landscape development. So basically, we've had a policy for the last 20 plus years of not doing cul-de-sacs. And as I stated earlier, every 10 acre parcel in town that currently cannot get a loop road through it with two connections would be subject to development, and you're opening it up to hundreds of additional lots. And we do not want to, I think, change what we've been doing for the last 20 years in that aspect.
And this is probably not the point in time to argue this, but my comment would be that putting a dead end with a turnaround on Chamberlain Street would be a huge improvement for public safety. And to make a connector road with through traffic would be a huge environmental impact.
I have a feeling we'll agree with you that, but the emergency access road gets us both what we want.
Mr. Chairman, sure. Members of the board, you're right. There is a policy or regulation, as you noted, on the cul-de-sacs, but there's also exceptional circumstances, and you just articulated our exceptional circumstances. And I would submit to you that the impact on the wetlands and the environmental impact on this development meets and qualifies under that exceptional circumstance that this board has carved out. And according to the packet that was submitted for this public hearing, there are multiple examples of where this board found exceptional circumstances. And I would submit again that those findings there pale in comparison to what environmental savings could be accomplished by permitting the two cul-de-sacs to remain here. There are two dead-end streets. We're not asking you to create new dead-end streets. We're asking you to continue the ones that have been in existence 1960s for Whalen Road, I think even before that for Chamberlain. But I think it's a little bit disingenuous to suggest that this has been a policy of this board not to find exceptions to the regulation that's there. The memo that's attached by Elaine Lazarus identifies, again, multiple exceptions to that general policy. And I think, again, this particular project rises to the level of exceptional circumstances, is this project. So I respectfully request that the board consider thoroughly examining this project and looking at it and making a determination that it does rise to the level of exceptional circumstances, and to let these two dead-end streets remain dead-end streets. Okay. Thank you.
To respond to that, this board has not added on this type of distance to any dead-end street that's there. You know, Whalen Road and Chamberlain Road are well before subdivision rules and regulations were done, probably before zoning for Chamberlain Street. Whalen Street was done maybe, in the 60s, right after zoning. I mean, we have not added thousands of feet on the end of it, and already thousands of feet dead end.
But your regulations don't say that. They simply say you can find exceptional circumstances.
We also have regulations that say all dead ends are not more than 1,000 feet. Right. That's part of the bylaw.
They're absolutely part of the bylaw.
That regulation. Yeah.
But all I'm saying is it can be considered. You can make a finding of exceptional circumstances. It is not black and white. It's not even charcoal gray. This board has discretion, and all I'm asking is that the board, before it makes a decision on this first day of a hearing, to fully consider the impact on this project and to consider finding that this does rise to the level of exceptional circumstances, and to let those two dead-end streets remain the same. Thank you.
Back to the chair. I'm talking for me individually, but I'm guessing we're starting a process. And at the start of the process, you're assuming that this would be approved. One of the things to be careful about, watch what you wish for, because we might say, and I don't know it is because we haven't started the process yet, we might say what's proposed as a connecting, we're not going to approve, doesn't meet the requirements, and we're not allowing the dead-end structures, and now you're arguing for us, where we wouldn't have considered the project of 34 lots, to make an exception to do the 34 lots. So what I'm saying is, at the start of the process, let's follow the process, be careful what you wish for, because the outcome may be that you're going to argue a level of development that may not happen, because again, we're starting the process and we've got to go through it. So I can understand being open-minded, but you're arguing allow 34 houses with two cul-de-sacs.
No, I wasn't. I was not arguing that at all. I was responding to a particular statement that was made about...
The public can't hear you if you're not tonight.
Sorry again, Don Caveney, 14 Whalen Road. Believe me, do not misinterpret what I was saying. I am not here. I have nothing against Mr. Mastriani. I met him one time, and we had a very nice conversation. I had a nice meeting. He was very kind to me. I think I returned it. It was kind to him. By me being here, I am not. I am not supporting 34 homes. I'm not supporting 12 homes. I just assume this thing not happen at all. I was responding to a particular statement that was made regarding cul-de-sacs. So again, just to eliminate confusion, I do not support 34 homes being built between Whalen Road and Chamberlain. Thank you.
Can you stay there 1 second? Because I wanted to
go. Go ahead.
So the chairman made a point that we're willing to entertain two cul-de-sacs with an emergency access road in between.
Sure.
But you're arguing that we're not allowing that. What's the big difference between two cul-de-sacs with no access road and
two cul-de-sacs with an access road.
There's a big difference because all of a sudden there's a road now, and just like on Legacy Farms, there was supposed to be retail as part of that project. McDonald came back, and the rules were changed, and so now we have more homes down there. So once that road is there, it is much easier for people to come back and say, you know what, the road's already there, let's get rid of the gate, because that just, it'll open up traffic.
That's perfect. I just wanted to understand where you were coming from.
That's where I'm coming from.
If I may, through the chair, Don, Mr. Cavini, I've known you for a number of years.
Yes.
Two things is, I'm agreeing with Mr. Ferrari, we don't know yet. I understand your point about your concern with Mr. Weismantle's statement, but I think Mr. Weismantle's outline with alternate plans, should we specifically address Mr. Kevin's concerns in section 7C? Is that the proper point in the discussion?
Yep.
So if I could make a suggestion, is if you could bring up some concrete points and examples of why what you're presenting, why you think it's correct, as opposed to right now you're telling us we have to do this as this. Well, we're trying to understand the whole deal.
Sure.
So if you can bring solid suggestions when we get to section 7CC, that would be very
I will. And again, I wasn't telling you what to do. I was just asking you to consider it. That's all. I wasn't. But my point.
Give
was
us something more to consider is what I'm asking. Because I know that you have.
You'll have. Points. You'll have that. Thank you. Thanks.
Okay, we're still on the conservation filing. Yep. Go ahead, Ms. Kramer.
Muriel Kramer, 39 North Street. I think that the gentleman was responding to the statement that you would not consider that option, and I'm wondering when the full hearing on that was. And how the board voted on that. I don't think that the board, I've listened tonight, you say you have to consider what's put in front of you. And in fact, you do. So maybe it's a message to the developer to make sure that you keep an open mind to what the neighbors who are already in existence can best possibly support and appreciate, and make sure you assert that in front of this board.
Right now, in this particular discussion item, we are trying to get the worst possible wetland impact and get the opinion from the Conservation Commission. That's what we're talking about. We will be down on item C talking about alternatives and stuff like that in that portion. I know what the answer is from the Conservation Commission with not having a through road through through a large wetland crossing and without the emergency access road. I know what that answer is. Of course they prefer that. That's easy. What I'm doing is giving them the hard question so that we get the answer on that particular one.
Hi, I'm Katie Kenny Caveney. I grew up on Whalen Road, and I've since purchased a home on Whalen Road and raised my children there now. So I've lived there essentially all of my life. So I obviously am very concerned about any extension, any through traffic, etc. I have a specific question. When you talk about a policy, that you refer to a policy for needing the public safety access, I'd be interested in hearing from the fire department or the public safety representatives about their perspective of that. Is that a policy, or is it really truly a public safety concern?
Deputy Miller, Hopkinton Fire Prevention Officer, Poria. In regards to, I believe you're talking about the road width, ma'am, is that what
yes,
you're referring to?
Exactly.
Okay. The subdivision bylaw, the town states the roads have to be X amount of width. The fire code 527 CMR 1, chapter 18, states it's a minimum of 20 feet.
Traveled way.
The section states also that we cannot go against a town bylaw. So what the town sets up is what we have to follow.
Okay? Thank you.
You're welcome.
Can I ask a question?
Sure.
If it's just an emergency access, does that have to be 20 feet?
Yes. Yep.
Might also just to add on to what I think you were asking was with regards to the emergency access, there's nothing in the fire code that requires it.
Correct.
Just understand that.
Thank you.
Yes.
That's
good.
Exactly what I was asking.
Okay.
Okay. Any further questions on 7A? I think we have enough. Oh. Go ahead.
I still remain a little bit confused as to kind of the interaction between CONCOM and this board on this particular bylaw, because I do see in the special permit criteria, and I don't know the specific section here, but I know it's sub 3E. It says the parcel, there must be a finding that the parcel could be developed as a conventional subdivision under existing local, state, and federal land use regulations. So does he have to go to, does he need a finding by the CONCOM that a conventional subdivision could be accomplished as he's presented it here? Does he need that approval that there's five crossings that are in that conventional plan would be approved? Because I know that the engineer talked about it's permissible, but that, I guess, would also mean that it's impermissible. So it doesn't mean that, again, it's more of a question. I'm a little bit confused as to...
From what I gather, CONCOM gives one crossing for sure, and everything else is at their discretion.
Based on the project.
And based on their project. And so, yes, we need the CONCOM to opine on whether or not that's something they would permit.
But this board doesn't give CONCOM input or feedback, or do they? That's a question.
It is kind of in parallel process with the applicant who's pushing for it. We're not pushing one project or another. We're not advocating for the project per se. It's the applicant to.
No, I'm not saying you are. I'm just.
I mean, so they have to make their case. It's two approvals. It's our approval, and at the end of the day, CONCOM has got to approve what gets built.
But this board is not going to make a decision that puts a condition on it that the applicant has to get CONCOM approval.
We could.
But I understand you could, but what is the board's practice on that? And does the board have an opinion as to?
We usually are going at both of them at the same pace, and we end up at the same, you know, at the very close to the same decision.
Okay. And I think one last comment. I've heard a couple of times a mention of the election and getting things done, and I just don't want, I'm not saying you are, but I just don't want this board to be rushing a decision on something as significant as this to beat a deadline because we have some elections coming on. I mean, the elections have been scheduled forever.
Trust me, we're not.
Well, I've heard a couple.
Last year, we made Mr. McDowell start brand new all over again. That's not our problem.
I agree. I hear you. I just heard a couple times about elections, and I just want to make sure that I'm not misinterpreting what the board's saying, and I'm not. Yep. So thank you.
Okay.
Ken.
Yep.
Before we move on from 7A.
Yep.
We had talked earlier about, I think during the overview, about the wetland impact on Chamberlain.
Yes.
So I just wanted to make sure
that was added. Yeah. Okay. And we won't close out 7A from the outline standpoint, because until we get answers back, you know, that's what will close it out. I think we're beyond 7A at this point. We're kind of putting it, we've got action items out there to get input from the Conservation Commission for us to make.
Sorry, let me just, something Don said kind of stuck in my head. Mr. Kevany, I served on the CONCOM for 3 years. If there was any particular issue that they disagreed with us about, they have powers over us concerning the wetlands. And if there's a certain lot that has an issue, that would have the right of way. We'd have to adhere to what they decide. That's their purview. So, like Ken said, it's two things are going on at once. The applicant's aware of the timing. If it doesn't happen, then we start over. And as we mentioned, like two or three times already. So, it's not going to be rushed. It's already, we're all say 7A, and it's 9:39. So, you know, it is what it is.
Yep. Okay. Let's go on to 7B, which is zoning compliance.
So the plan complies with all the zoning as far as the setbacks and the lot sizes. The only thing that was mentioned was the waiver, one waiver request for the 100-foot buffer along the Chamberlain side, right? Yeah. So that's the one thing the board will have to consider as far as zoning compliance.
Is that all four plans, or when you said it complies?
Yes, all the different alternatives.
Okay, thank you.
Yes.
So basically, and this board has approved, has waived some of the 100-foot buffer on multiple projects. That is not, I'll say, uncommon. We try not to waive it when we have residential abutters. We're very careful on that aspect of it. But just about every one of these, it's kind of hard to put a 100-foot around every project completely.
Mm-hmm.
The waiver request is really, it's town land, I believe, that we're abutting, correct?
Well, yeah, what were the lot numbers again? Sorry. Was it 34?
It would be the area right along Chamberlain Road. So lot 34.
33. 33, 32, 31, 30, and then 20, 20, 20.
Do you want to use the colors?
If you want to, you can. If that makes it clearer for them.
Yeah. What page do you want?
6 of 10.
6 of 10. This is clear on 8
point
of 10.
Point of order through the chair.
Yeah, go ahead.
At what point does the planning board consider the waiver?
We're talking about it now. The waiver will end up being part of the decision criteria at the end. So it'll be in context of everything.
Thank you.
One of the conditions.
Yep. Okay, so we're...
So yeah, the waiver request is simply going to be for the lots
along Chamberlain Road, the right-of-way. It's simply 4 to 5 lots that abut Chamberlain and the town-owned land. The remaining parcels can all meet the 100-foot setback. So the actual impact to abutting, the nearest abutting house, I think, is 500 feet away from house to house.
So really the impact...
There's also less about the way on the moon side. It's 1 mile away from the road. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Or is that the open
space? This, yeah, the open space plan.
I don't know.
What's that?
So if I look at that plan where these lots are, Mark, maybe you can see from the color one, basically we're really talking about the back end of the ball field area with an awful lot of woods. About how many feet would that wooded area be to the back of the ball field?
It's probably about 600 feet or so.
Okay.
Covered by a conservation restriction.
Right, so that woods will remain there forever.
Correct.
So
through the chair, can you explain, if I can, if we do not approve the waiver, how that would affect the plan that we're looking at on page 6? Is that, because we're only considering this for page 6? Is that? Because different plans have different lot locations, so that's why I'm a little.
6. Correct.
So because there are different lot locations on different plans and we don't have the earth science in place yet, I'm not sure how we can actually consider this other than just a general yes or no.
Just to clarify, there are not different lots on each of the concept plans that we submitted. The difference between the plans was in the, whether it was a cut through road,
just the center,
the emergency access road, or two cul-de-sacs. So it was just in the center of that wetland.
Because I was under the impression that if there is not, if there are two cul-de-sacs as an option, then less houses would be allowed.
Yes. Well, we have a bylaw that only allows 10 houses on a cul-de-sac, too.
Right. So that being the case, I mean, that's also something we should, well, it's an option that we get to later in 7CC, but it kind of affects talking about a waiver now, because I'm not sure what it affects and what doesn't affect.
Well, I think what you ought to take away now is if we were to grant this waiver, we're not looking like we're next to somebody's house with it, but we're looking at 600 feet of protected wood area behind in the next, it's a ball field on the other side.
All right, so for clarification, now, I can't see exactly where you are, but the closest home to this buffer, to this area that would be affected by a waiver is whom?
It would be this one right here.
Ted Stone property.
Ted Stone property.
And then there's a house just before the bend.
And that house would be someone who's asked me about this in the audience?
It's you, John. Boba, I'm sorry. Yeah, 46 Chamberlain Street.
Yeah. And someone next to you. you were asking about this earlier.
I was?
Yes. Do you have any questions about it? Do you have any questions about it?
No.
I mean, if you were to draw the buffer into that area, you'd probably lose two or three lots, I would think.
Well, the road would have to get shifted down closer to the wetlands into the buffer zones. Wouldn't be more filling, but it'd just be a realigning of the roadway further south or southwest, and just getting into more buffer zone areas.
Which also might happen through the chair, based on the earth science that we don't have in hand yet. Is that fair to say?
No, I think that's the wetland criteria earth science you're referring to.
Yep.
Yeah. No, that wouldn't affect that.
Okay. I'm going to say, are we approaching another vote on this?
What? No. We're not going to vote on this at all.
Okay. Okay.
No.
It's going to be a long time before a vote.
So, any other comments, questions on zoning compliance?
I have a question. There were two houses in the original plan that were in the hotel district. I think it was the hotel district, which is not allowed. Is that?
No.
Were they moved? That's what I thought I saw in the findings.
The hotel overlay district.
No, the office park.
I didn't think it was. I thought it said hotel district, though. I didn't think it said office park.
District, but that's been removed.
So they took them out.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay, I think zoning compliance we're all set on. Check that one off. Now we're on road layout and design, and let's.
Well, with the, you still got that question on the zoning compliance of the 100-foot buffer. That's still open on zoning compliance B.
Well, it's something that we will address when we get down to conditions of approval.
Yeah, so we're not gonna close that.
We've gathered all the information on it at this point. I mean, that's what we do in item 7.
Okay.
So we have all the information from it, and you know it's the question is still to be debated.
Sure.
At the end of it. Okay. Let's.
I'm not sure how much more we can discuss on road layout until we hear from conservation.
We've got 10 or 12 minutes, so let's kind of introduce the subject.
Okay.
And then particularly talking about the alternate plans, because CONCOM is going to give us a lot of good information on that.
I'm kind of in agreement with Jen, is that even to bring this topic up, we're kind of putting the cart before the horse.
And to add on to that through the chair, I like the motion that we think of adjourning, or at least throw out the idea that we think of adjourning for now, because it's a pretty heady topic to get into with 11 minutes left, and I really need to make a hard call at 10 o'clock.
Do we want to jump down to like something like stormwater management and come back up, or?
I would prefer to follow Frank's lead.
Yeah, I don't see anything else that's easy to talk about.
Yes, ma'am.
Ask a question.
If you need to come to the mic.
Is there another open meeting before you do your site plan walk?
No.
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 Okay.
Go ahead, one more time.
She needs to come up to the mic.
All right. So this will be quick. It is 7I. I'll be less than 11 minutes.
Especially since you're talking while you're walking.
Okay, yes. It's a habit, a bad habit.
Name an address.
Ann Matina, 40 Eastview Road. I'm president of the Hopkinton Historical Society, and we're interested in the plan development over lots 27 and 28, which is the site of a historic cellar hole, which some of you are familiar with. I know you've gotten a letter regarding it. We are a little late to the game in terms of this. I met last week with the Historic Commission on this because it's part of the state has a concern about historic cellar holes, as well as wells, as well as dry rock fences, which are all part of that area in where 27 and 28 is going to go. Okay. The state has taken the position that these should be preserved, and in reading our master plan and reading other things that the town has done over the last 20 years or so, we think that this is a significant archaeological site.
We're a little bit out of order per se from the outline standpoint, but let me turn this into an action item on the developer.
Okay.
Number one, I want to see it when we do the site walk.
Right.
And two, I want the engineer to put it on a map so we know exactly where it is.
Okay. That is the reason why I came up, because I wanted to make sure that was part of your tour when you went your walk on the 22nd, and it's a wonderful place. You should definitely take a good look at it.
Okay. Are there any other things that on our site walk that people suggest we need to go see? I mean, a lot of you guys have probably all walked it one way at a time or another.
Mr. Chairman, I do want to see some of the trails as they go through the wetlands.
Okay.
Bob Barnes, 44 Chamberlain Street. Mm-hmm. Regarding the site walk, if you're starting at Chamberlain Street, you can park in my driveway, 44, and you'll see that if they widen the road, I'm going to lose half my front lawn. I'll be the closest house on the road. So take that in consideration if you're going over 20 feet with sidewalks and whatever else is going to happen. Okay. Thanks.
Mm-hmm. To that point, can you go back up for a second? I think it was clearly stipulated that what we have for the town's property.
I know I don't own the middle of the street starts at the end of my driveway.
Yeah, I'm understanding that.
Yeah.
But to that point, it's very difficult if your property is utilizing some of the town
property. I know.
It's very hard for us to.
And the rock wall in front of my house is.
Yes.
Probably over 100 years old.
Yes, so this is why we want this public input from everybody, and how it impacts everybody. So thank you for getting up there and saying that, but please understand the dynamic of what we're put in front of, is that piece of property is town owned already.
Yeah, no, I know.
Okay, so we're trying to do the best that we can with that, and I'm humbled by your.
So drag this project out as long as you can so I can sell.
Okay. Through the chair, though, Mr. Barnes' property, the scenic roadway, the stone wall's right there. The modern definition of a street and a road being 20 foot wide doesn't exactly fit the reality, as we'll see.
Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay, go.
Hi, Jen Trendle, 31 Chamberlain Street. I, on occasion, go back on the property, and years ago, before it was sold, I actually rode my horse back along there. It was a great trail. One of the other neighbors who's no longer on Chamberlain Street, she frequented it quite often. Now, if I do visit, I run, and I love the property that's back there. I am definitely a bit concerned about losing the wildlife and the beautiful trails that are back there. I realize that it pushes all that wildlife off back behind the other homes that are there, but it is really beautiful there, and there's been owl sightings, and we have lots of deer, and it's really stunning. So hopefully you take into account how beautiful the property actually is and how it's been used for so many purposes. So thank you.
If you may, through the chair.
Go ahead, Cliff.
Just know that Mr. Mastriani owns that land.
I understand that.
And so we as the board have to do the best due diligence in order to accommodate everybody involved.
Absolutely, and
so,
I understand.
So
that.
Again, I hear your wishes and favor them and looking forward, but I also know that capitalism is what.
Absolutely. At the same time, I think that it can be done in a way that benefits not only Mr. Mastriani, but also the
yes.
citizens of Hopkinton. And if you've ever been back on that property where it connects to Berry Acres, I mean, it's wonderful. And I run into people all the time. The people that are that cross-country ski in the wintertime, you know, it's really a great place. So I think that if there's some way to preserve that beautiful aspect of Hopkinton, I think that that is really important. I think that that will be certainly missed if all that land, I understand that there's some of that land is being preserved as the open space possibly, but there's just so much to be offered back there, so.
Sure.
Thank you.
Thank you.
To the chair. One of these pages shows the, Mr. Mastriani has considered this and presented alternative ideas to the trail, so it's kind of covered. We'll talk about it.
Okay. Yep. Go ahead.
I'm Jen Tedstone. I'm 49 Chamberlain Street. I'm the very last house on the street. And if, when you guys do go do your site work, I just want you guys to realize how safety is important to me and my kids, who are going to be in their front yard and are going to be impacted by this. So I really hope you guys all take an account to safety, because that's my biggest concern right now.
Absolutely.
Okay, I think we're at the hour at this point. What time?
8:15 on April 24th.
8:15 on April 24th. Entertaining motion to continue
here.
The public hearing to 8:15 on the 24th of 8:15.
So moved.
Second. Do I hear?
What? Is that the same night as the CONCOM?
Yes, it is.
How can we?
Are you going to have input?
Yes.
Well, we're hoping that CONCOM will have stuff early in their meeting. We'll try to coordinate it with them.
Where is CONCOM meeting? Do we even know?
We don't even know where CONCOM's meeting these days. But
what about the concerned citizens who want to hear votes?
They want to what?
Hear
votes. They have concerns at both meetings.
Well, we're going to find a place. It might not be here. Cause
we have to name the date and time and place certain right now.
Yeah.
So
that's a Monday?
Eight. Is Jim?
He already said we could have this.
We could have it over that other?
Do it
they're at the library.
They're going to go at the library?
At the library.
Oh, the Know Your Vote's going to go to the library?
That's what they said to you earlier.
Okay. Yeah.
If we get the information before.
I don't know where CONCOM is meeting. I mean, the town hall thing screwed everything up yesterday, so I don't know where CONCOM is meeting. They don't even know where they're going.
Pick a different day.
So we did, through the chair, we did talk
about
this
earlier.
That's
just our next meeting. It's up to the board.
And the applicant's aware of the situation, and if we don't get the communication from Conservation Commission because of these difficulties, he's aware of the difficulties.
So will you postpone? You don't have the information?
If we don't have the information, we're not going to make much of a decision. We won't make a lot of progress on that meeting, but it's obvious. But we'll see where we're at. Entertain a motion. I think we have
point
a motion.
Of, point of order here is that the guests are talking about coming out and attending another meeting to voice their opinion, yet we're talking about, well, we don't know if we're going to facilitate that meeting. I think.
Well, we Cliff, we can talk about traffic and other things without having the CONCOM?
I don't even, that's what we're paused on right now, is that because we don't have that information, that we can't make that decision.
We probably won't make a decision next meeting.
I understand that, but these folks are all coming out, Ken, for this particular project. They're putting a lot of effort in to make this, and we don't want to put constraints on these people that are coming out of their homes to represent their issue with this, and not give them due process to be able to do that.
They will have due process.
Well, it's a
chair. I have to say, you know, I do agree with what Cliff is saying. All these people have come out here because they're concerned about this project. Now they're going to be torn between coming to the planning board meeting and the conservation commission meeting. You know, and they can't be at two places at once, unfortunately. Yeah. No one can. So we need to give them the opportunity to be able to go to the meetings that they want to go to. We have the opportunity to postpone our continuation of this meeting, and I think that we should consider what the public is looking for and postpone our meeting to after a time that Conservation Commission has come up with their decision.
I withdraw my motion. Yeah. I withdraw my motion that I moved, that Ken made, and I think we should discuss a little bit the planning for this next two meetings with CONCOM and us, maybe a little bit right now.
Well,
I can make a motion.
It's hard as it might be because they're CONCOM here.
Can people make that Wednesday?
Yeah, I'd like to make a motion that we meet the Wednesday.
Second.
2 days later.
Will that give us enough time to actually look at the information ourselves?
Why not, Jen?
What's this?
Yes, will that give us enough time?
Well, you will have...
Talking 26, that is a candidate.
Probably with a little bit of luck, a letter.
That's candidates night.
That's candidates night.
Yes, here.
No, that's not too good.
Tuesday?
I honestly think that we're yeah, well, we don't have enough time.
At that point, just move it to your next meeting, May 8th. I mean, right. You've got town meeting coming up the following week. I mean,
do it on the 8th.
Okay.
Let's go. I mean, I'm just making a suggestion to the board. I mean, why are we trying to find a day that...
And if that's the case, I'm sorry to interrupt, but should we ask the proponent if they want to just postpone until the next planning board meets? After the election. I mean, I don't think we can knock this out on May 8th.
I don't think we can either. And I'm in agreement with.
But I don't think we should necessarily just forestall the process.
No.
What?
Well, that's going to have to be a withdrawal and resubmittal, just as an FYI.
That's more what it looks like to me. And I'm sorry that it's come in front at this 11th hour. In our process.
Apologize to me. Apologize to them.
I'm saying that to everybody involved. I really wish that there was a better forum than to be pushed in front of us this way. But it's here and we're dealing with it. So I'm looking at you all, and I want you all to be represented. And I'm looking at you, and I want you to be represented. And we're doing, as our board, doing our due diligence to hear both sides. And in order to facilitate that, sorry, John, that I think that we, as the board, should look at this and say, this is being pushed too fast.
Through the chair. Just for those who are unfamiliar with it and why this discussion is taking place, is in order for somebody to vote, they have to have attended the meetings, and they can miss one but have to watch the tape. So what will happen is with the vote, you will have new members who weren't members, so therefore didn't attend the meetings, so therefore couldn't vote. So that is, I wanted to give you the background reason for why talking about it. So if it's not decided before the vote and the new planning board members come on board,
the process restarts.
The process has to restart. So that's why this discussion is taking place, just to give you a background.
Through the chair, I just want to make a point that I think we should work on a schedule, but I think we should address things in 2 weeks. I don't think we should
agree
a 1 month period before we continue discussions here. I think we should try to, you know, meet at a different time than the Conservation Committee, And if we don't get their feedback, I think we should talk about other things on the list.
I don't agree with that.
Why don't you want to talk about stormwater management?
Because how can we do that without the Concom's information? How can we do that?
There's a lot of things we can talk about independent of their information.
Well, road layout and all this other stuff, I mean, seriously.
We can come back to that.
We've skipped around on the outline many times, Cliff.
All right. Yeah. Let it be known that I state my opposition.
I agree with Cliff, and as I mentioned several times, but if the applicant wants us to push forward with it, the reality is I don't think we're going to, with the water problem at Town Hall or not, I don't think we'll meet.
And to that point, look it out in the public right now.
Right.
We look out, and these people are all coming out.
Yep.
To make themselves heard, and for us to overlook that and to make a slight of that, I'm not saying that we're doing that. I'm not. But what I'm saying is, right now they've got to keep coming out, and I like the fact that you people are involved. I like the fact that we, as a board, are hearing both mm-hmm. sides of this and working together.
Mm-hmm.
And if this can happen at town meetings, at everything else that comes across our desks when it need be, then we have public involvement. And that is the most important thing that this town needs right now and going into the future from this point on.
I have a question for the chair. It's an operational question. Maybe through the chair to Jen, would it be possible to maybe get two classrooms or maybe something like that at one of the schools?
I mean, without
or
talking to the school department,
without,
knowing it's
right.
available, I can't do that. And because we're in an open public hearing, we have to continue to a date
right.
and time and place certain so
right.
that all these
right.
folks know where and when we will meet again.
The difficulty is beyond out of our hands.
Okay. It sounds like
Jen had some input.
For clarification, the initial decision that we're looking for from Concom, I thought was in regards to the conventional plan feasibility, so at least we could move forward on that aspect of the plan as far as the number of lots and the feasibility of that moving forward. That was our number one intent with Concom on April 24th. If we were to first get that decision, and then we would that allow us to progress while Concom considered the other four items or so that you added to their list, because those are in relation to us moving past the conventional to the concept plan.
If they approve the conventional plan, all the others are better in their opinion than that. What?
We're not actually filing anything to be approved.
Right. No, right. If we get the opinion from
just an
Concom,
opinion saying, is it feasible that you can
and you accept
that you can
that.
Do
yeah.
That's all.
Yeah.
I mean,
yeah.
If you're looking for a full blown plan,
right.
then tell me that, and then I'll go do it. You know, file an NOI. I'll go obviously, you know, put together the full plans. But it's kind of ridiculous that I'm going to do that when we know I'm not going to build that anyway.
Yeah.
So all we're really trying to do is that figure out how many lots can be built with conventional plans. So basically right now with the conventional plan, there's 35 lots that can be built. So we, with the next plan, with the two cul-de-sacs, with the, not the through road, because I really don't think that's gonna happen, just my opinion.
Paul, can you maybe speak at the microphone?
Sure.
Thanks.
It's the quietest I've been for a long time.
My name is Paul Mastriani. So I think we're getting bogged down here with the only reason why we're even doing the conventional plan is to figure out how many lots we can have. That's really all it's about, because we all know that we're not doing the conventional plan. So it's going to basically come down to doing the open space plan, whereas we're going to be, I'm not sure exactly how many acres, but we're going to be donating, I think, 50 acres or 45 acres. So how many acres? 42. Sorry. Well, if I give them the other 18 acres on the
industrial, right.
then it's up to 60. So anyway, so the point is, if we did have another meeting, we're assuming that we're going to be doing the open space. All we're trying to do with the conventional plan is to see, is it feasible to be able to get 35 acres? We're not going there to definitively say we're going to get them, definitively say we're not going to get them. We're just going in front of the conservation to get the input to say, yes, this is feasible that you could build 35 lots. That's really all it comes down to. So as far as going forward, I think I'd obviously like to have a meeting. If I have to wait, then again, I don't want to, but I will. I think at the end of the day, and as a developer, I will push for having two cul-de-sacs with you know, the emergency access. I don't want a throughway. If I live in that street, I feel the same way all of you do. So it just comes down to how many lots, basically, with the conventional plan. Because the road is still going to stay the same if we go with the open space.
Okay, Jen, what is our time on the 8th?
Right now you have nothing scheduled, so you can do 7:30.
7:30? I think that works out the best at this point. People agree?
Yeah,
I entertain a motion to 7:30 on the 8th.
So moved.
Me?
So point of clarification, yeah. Is there still going to be a meeting on the 21st?
Our regular meeting. We still have items on
yes.
the 24th.
Okay. This
topic will
on
not be on
May
the 24th.
Right. We do have another
we have
person.
Other stuff.
Yep.
Normal stuff.
But we don't. You just said there's nothing else on.
No.
On the 8th.
Yes,
on the 24th.
Oh.
The 24th, we have other items on the agenda.
Oh, okay.
Okay, so entertain a motion. I think I got it.
It was moved. No, second.
Second.
Okay. Moved and seconded to continue the hearing to 7:30 on the May 8th. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone
nay.
Abstain? Okay.
Because I'm certain it's not going to get done in time and I don't want to rush it.
For May
8th? Vote is to continue, 8-1 to continue. Okay. Entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and second. All those in favor of adjourning, say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Same motion carries.